Hey, good morning, Scandia. Great to see you all here today. Again, I don't take any of these days for granted. If we can meet, it's a wonderful gift from the Father. Before I go to a call to worship this morning and we move into the rest of our service, just want to remind you all that there are indeed two services today. There's a lot of confusion about that. There are two services. So we have our morning service, which you know if you're here. But there is an evening service out at the Craft Farm, and I have to tell you, this thing has been evolving dramatically over the last 7 days. So we have a living nativity, we have, I believe, things to drink, some things to eat. The crafts have been working hard along with some other people, and so come on out. It's going to be a short service. Put on your bibbed overalls, and we're going to have an outdoor communion service, about 30 minutes, I would say, the whole thing. We'll sing, we'll have a short meditation, we'll take communion together. So invite your neighbors if you want and come on out. It should be a good evening. Also, we are keeping the Thanksgiving love offering open for another couple weeks, trying to pay off the cost of a utility shed. Hopefully we can get that done this winter. The call to worship comes from the Psalms, Psalm chapter 65. The psalmist writes, "By awesome deeds you answer us with righteousness, O God of our salvation, the hope of all the ends of the earth and the farthest seas." Do you feel that? Do you believe that God is the hope of all the ends of the earth? "The one who by his strength established the mountains, being girded with might, who stills the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, the tumult of the peoples, so that those who dwell at the ends of the earth are in awe of your signs." Let's pray together. Father, there is no place in the universe where your awesome deeds are not felt and seen. The psalmist writes of that might, and we know that your might was most profoundly displayed through the gift of Jesus. And so as we come together to sing praises to you, as we come together to meditate on your word together and pray together, we ask that you would receive these acts of worship and that we would be people whose hearts are soft and ready to receive what you have for us today. It is in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.
Want to stand again with me?
Joy to the world. Makes the nation through the wonders of his love, and wonders of his love. Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, O thou of God and man, the Son, thee will I cherish, thee will I honor, thou my soul's glory, joy, and crown. Fair are the meadows, fairer still the woodlands, Jesus is fairer, Jesus is purer, who makes the woeful heart to sing. Fair is the sunshine, fairer still the moonlight, and all the twinkling starry hosts. Jesus shines brighter, Jesus shines purer than angels can boast. All fairest beauty, heavenly and earthly, wondrously Jesus is found in thee. None can be nearer, fairer, or dearer than thou, my Savior, art to me. Beautiful Savior, Lord of all nations, Son of God and Son of Man, glory and honor, praise adoration, now and forevermore be thou.
going to move into a time of prayer. As we do, we continue to pray for our nation, our world. It is appropriate to ask God to relent. Nothing is outside of His sovereign hand, I realize. And so, lamenting and longing and asking God to release all of this is appropriate. So would you join me together as we pray in that vein, concertedly? Father, thank you for giving us breath to sing this morning. There is much pain and sorrow in the world that we live in. And in your grace, you have made a way for human hearts to be transformed so that in the midst of the pain and the sorrow, we can sing. We can proclaim that you have sent your Son to let your blessings flow to mankind as far as the curse is found. You are undoing it in Jesus. And Romans says, what should we say to these things? If our God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? And so, Lord, in this year of turmoil, we pray that you might relent, that you might bring an end to the virus, that you might bring peace into our politics, that you would restore businesses. But more than anything, we pray that you would bring revival to this land, and the hearts of many men and women would be yielded to you and embrace what your Son has done on the cross. Transform us, Father. Bring revival to our land and begin it with us. Father, we thank you that you are with us. We thank you for the opportunity to proclaim and celebrate the incarnation. And so now, as we turn our attention to Luke's gospel again, we are asking you for your aid, because these are your words and no one understands them as you do. And so please let the words of my mouth and let the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, because you are our rock and our redeemer. Holy Spirit, come and break through the stoniness of our hearts, and through the ministry of your word, as your Spirit opens us, let our hearts become soft, supple, fertile ground to receive the seeds of faith that you would plant in us today. Father, we need you. We don't need a vaccine as much as we need you. We don't need the governor to relent as much as we need you. We have all kinds of things that we think we need. What we need is you and your presence and the peace that you provide. And so we ask for it today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, if you have a Bible, I would invite you to open it to the Gospel of Luke. Just a couple things while you are doing that. Again, we don't have children's church currently, so there are busy bags in the back for younger kids, for older kids. There are note pages and coloring pages in the back. And I also forgot to mention that if you do want to come out to Christmas at the Farm, the craft, their address is in the bulletin, so go ahead and note that. It's only about 4 miles to the west and a little bit to the south of here. Luke chapter 2. I invite you to stand if you are able while we read the text. We will begin reading at verse 22. And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what it is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. And his father and his mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel and for a sign that is opposed. And a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts will be revealed. These are God's words. You may be seated. So in 1862, the American poet Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, maybe you read his poems in middle school and high school, is one of the most famous poets in American history. In 1862, he buried his wife of 18 years. It devastated him. If you look up pictures of Longfellow, you usually see this bedraggled guy with this big bushy beard. And the thing is, he didn't grow that beard until his wife died. It was a state of mourning that he just didn't really care about his appearance very much. He felt as though all the joy and peace had been sucked out of his life. A year later, in 1863, with the Civil War raging, his son joined the Union Army and went down south to fight and was wounded so badly he was discharged and put back into Longfellow's care. Christmas of that year, with the Civil War raging, Longfellow penned a poem called Christmas Bells, and many of you know it because Burl Ives recorded it in 1968 into a song. Let me read some of the words to this poem. He says, I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Then from each black a cursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south. See the mention of the Civil War there? And with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men. It was as if an earthquake rent the hearthstones of a continent and made forlorn the households born of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And then these lines, and in despair, I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. We don't need a civil war or the death of a spouse or the maiming of a son in order to understand the heartache of Longfellow and the reality that human existence is in a constant search for peace. If anything, 2020 has confirmed this, right? And yet today is the fourth Sunday of Advent, and today we have lit the peace candle, and we're asking this question, how has Jesus become our peace? And the question even leads to a deeper question, I think. If Jesus indeed came and became our peace, then why for the last 2,000 years has peace been so hard to find by the human race? How could a year like 2020 even exist if Jesus came to be our peace? I think the answer to these questions can be found by looking at an elderly man named Simeon. But before you can even look at this text that Luke writes and mentions this guy, Simeon, you have to understand the context that Simeon lives in. So if you take your Bibles and you open them to the end of the book of Malachi, which is right in the middle of your Bible, that's the last book in the Old Testament. In fact, I want you to do this. Take a Bible and just do this so you can see this. Zechariah, Malachi. And then you have the beginning of Matthew, and in between there, you have this one page. You see that? Mine says New Testament, right? That page represents 400 years of history. 400 years of history between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New. We call this the era of silence because God was silent. But that didn't mean that he wasn't working in the lives of people. What it means is there were no prophets, there was no revelation, there were no new books of the Bible being written at this time, no great leaders hearing from God in the way that we are accustomed to having people in the Bible hear from God. And it also happens to be a time of fantastic geopolitical turmoil in modern-day Israel. So from the time that the Hebrew dynasty came to an end and then they're carted off to Babylon, And then finally they come back. All kinds of upheaval happen. So take a look at this map. You have the Assyrian army coming in. And so there's a color-coded thing there because that's where Israel, Palestine is. The Assyrian army comes in 722 and wipes out the northern kingdom. It's gone. Never comes back. And in so doing, they make the southern kingdom... Northern kingdom's wiped out. They make the southern kingdom basically a vassal state until the Assyrian army is destroyed by an army called Babylon. The Babylonians wipe out the southern kingdom and cart them all off. It's during the Persian Empire, which the Persians wipe out the Babylonians, that the king allows the Hebrews to go back to their homeland. And it's at that time that the 400 years actually begins. So when this time of silence begins, they've already been the kicking boy for everybody. Shortly after this, Alexander the Great comes and starts the Greek Empire. And this is a really terrible time for the Jews because the Greeks imposed their language and their religion and their government. For a couple centuries, they imposed these things upon them. How do you think Hebrew people who are trying to live devout lives feel about having a pantheon of gods foisted upon them by the Greeks? They hate it. So in 164 BC, the Maccabean revolt happens. And actually for about 100 years, we have a sovereign Jewish state again. It's kind of good for about 100 years, but that's it. And then the Romans take over in 63 BC. So by the time that the Romans have conquered, the Hebrew people are in complete turmoil. Some were still fighting for their independence, and some were just trying to maintain their faith and do the best they can do in the midst of a massive amount of adversity. And to be honest with you, other Jews just didn't really care anymore. They just wanted to be left alone. So what I'm trying to communicate is that peace at the time of Roman conquest is really hard to come by. And yet there's this collective knowledge amongst the Jewish people that is passed down from generation to generation to generation. And it's founded in the scriptures that God spoke through the prophets that there was a hope coming to them and a peace coming to them. From the time of Moses, this has been happening. Moses described this person as the greatest of all the prophets in Israel. David was told that he would come from David's own family line, and the prophets spoke of his ministry in words like this, that those who walk in darkness would see a great light. Do you see the peace and hope in that? And also that he would usher in a new covenant with the people in which the blood of animals would no longer be needed to cover sin. He would actually, according to Jeremiah 31, he would write the law upon their hearts so that they would know what is right and wrong. They would be so purified that they would want to do what is right. And to this end, the people wait and wait and wait. And some grew tired of waiting and they stopped believing. And others went about their lives earning money, making a living, trying to do the best they can under Roman oppression. They didn't necessarily disbelieve the Messiah was coming, some of them, but they also didn't spend a lot of time thinking about it because it's been so long. And so it's into this context that we meet this guy named Simeon. And the text says in verse 25 that Simeon was a righteous and devout man waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. So we don't know much about Simeon. This is actually the only mention of him in all the Bible. In these short verses, he is most likely advanced in years. The language used to describe him is one of faith and devotion. But why does he need devotion? Remember who's in control. It's the Romans. In fact, the very temple that this whole thing is set in has this structure that the Romans built right next to it. So if you look at this picture, the lower left-hand corner is actually the inside temple court. And right next to it is a Roman structure called the Antonius Fortress. And what you need to know about this fortress is it was put there intentionally by the Romans for several reasons. One is so that they could peek down inside the most holy of holy places for the Jewish people and thumb their noses at the Jews and say, "You think your God is all that? Look at who we are. We control everything." The Antonius Fortress is, for all intents and purposes, the Romans saying, "Your God is upstaged by us. We are the power here, not your God." And so Simeon lives in this world. Verse 25 says that he's waiting for the consolation of Israel, which is an amazing word, consolation. It means to bring comfort, to bring rest, to bring peace. And so this is precisely what Simeon is waiting for God to do what he said he would do. Waiting for him to do what he said he would do in Isaiah 40. When he says, "Comfort, comfort my people," says your God. "Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare's ended, her iniquity is pardoned." Do you see those words? That she's received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. It's all done. It's repaid. You're good. He's waiting for this comfort. He's waiting for this consolation and for this peace. And he's waiting amongst the people who've been waiting for 400 years. 400 years of oppression. 400 years of heartache. 400 years of forgetfulness and lack of interest. 400 years of silence. 400 years of wavering hope. Where is this Messiah? You've promised he would come. Why aren't you sending him? Do you not even care? Can we even trust your words anymore? And Simeon had to have some of the same struggles. And yet Luke's gospel gives us an important insight. It says that he's filled with the Holy Spirit. Do you see that? Which prior to Jesus coming, you can't take for granted, because the Holy Spirit came and went upon people. Usually when they were prophesying, or when God was raising them up to do something big for the nation, like Samson, the Holy Spirit would come upon a person and the Holy Spirit would leave. We take that for granted because the Bible says that a Christian, someone who's been born again, has actually had their own will die, and the will of God has been put into them through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives in them as a down payment of greater things to come. Can't assume that in the Old Testament. And so Simeon is filled with the Holy Spirit. And it says in verse 26 that it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Isn't that an interesting turn in the story? This significant and massive promise that he's been given. Simeon is promised he won't taste death. He won't die until he sees the Messiah. And so with that promise, verse 27, it says he came in the Spirit into the temple on a particular day. This unique person that he's not just waiting a lot, he's listening a lot. And so one day he gets up, going about his normal routine. I don't know what Simeon's routine was. If he had eggs, he wouldn't have bacon. He's Jewish. Toast. Holy Spirit impresses upon him that morning the need to go to the temple. Why? What could the reason be to go to the temple? 1,000 thoughts might have gone through Simeon's mind. Undoubtedly, he had plans that day. Important things to accomplish. I don't know. He could have easily said, I have a busy day. I'm going to go to the temple tomorrow. But Simeon was a man who listened. And so when the Spirit impressed upon him the need to go to the temple, he goes to the temple. How long did he wait at the temple? I don't know. It's another statement of his faith in God. It could have been an hour. It could have been 10 hours that he waited at the temple. But there he is when suddenly the Holy Spirit causes him to notice a man and a young woman holding a baby. And why he would notice this, we don't know. Because there's nothing unique about a man and a woman bringing their firstborn child to the temple. The text actually says that this was in the law of Moses. The law said, when you have your first son, you are to bring him to the temple and you're to make a sacrifice, a thanks sacrifice to the Lord, and you're to dedicate that child to the Lord. A thank offering. And what's interesting about this scenario is it actually shows the poverty of this couple that he sees, because Moses' law says that they should bring a lamb or a goat, but it gives an exception clause to those who are poor that they could bring pigeons or doves if they can't afford the lamb or the goat. This is a family of no consequence, do you understand? They could barely afford the pigeons. So why would Simeon be led by the Holy Spirit to this family? There's nothing unique about them. But he does. He approaches them. He's a stranger. Mothers, do you ever have strangers come and ask if they can hold your baby? Isn't that an interesting scenario? They don't know Simeon. But he reaches out his arms to take the child. And I think the contrast has to be a bit stunning. Simeon's gnarled old hands next to the new flesh of an infant baby. And the text indicates that as soon as Simeon takes the child, he knows why he's there. He understands exactly why his day has been changed. This is not a mere baby. It's the Messiah. And Simeon looks upon this promised one, and he cannot help but to speak this song that God begins to reveal to him. It's a poem, it's a song in the language that he spoke. Verse 29, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen, I've seen your salvation that you prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory in your people Israel. Do you feel the sacredness of this moment, of what this means? And nobody knows how long Simeon's lived with the promise. I think probably for years. Waiting, waiting, waiting in this time between the testaments, waiting. And now he's holding the consolation of Israel. He's holding this consolation in his arms. He's staring into the eyes of the one who will bring redemption, not just for Israel, but he's been given insight for all the nations, for the Gentiles even, will unite these peoples into one people of God. And as he holds this baby, clearly Simeon's brain begins to formulate some details that the Holy Spirit gives him that have not been spoken to this point. And it's something that neither Simeon nor Mary nor Joseph were ready to hear. Verse 34, Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel and a sign that will be opposed. How would you like to hear your baby boy is going to be opposed by many? And he's going to cause a lot of people to fall. This is really hard news to hear. And then he speaks directly to Mary and says, a sword is going to pierce through your very soul. This child will hurt you. So that the thoughts from many hearts may be revealed, something this baby will do will pierce to the core of what a human being is. We'll see everything. And what Simeon understands right now is that the comfort of Israel will not arrive through peaceful means. Even as he holds this baby in his arms, he realized the child's not going to bring peace, but a sword. Peace will come to individuals who believe in him, but this same one will divide nations, will divide families. The rival of this baby boy will even pierce his own mother's soul. And I can't help but to wonder, because of where they're standing, if Simeon, as he holds the baby in his arms, is not overwhelmed by what he's seeing around him. Blood is everywhere. The sounds of death are everywhere. On the brazen altar, you have animals burning as a sacrifice unto God. Blood is spilling out from the necks of other animals that are waiting to go on the altar. They're gasping for breath as their blood pours out over to the white stone as a substitutionary atonement for sin. He's looking at this as he holds this baby. Is it possible that Simeon begins to understand what has to happen? That this child's blood will be spilled, and this child will also gasp for breath, that he will be pierced as a substitutionary atonement, not just for the sins of Israel, but for the sins of the entire world. Did you see that the things that Simeon says are so shocking that Mary and Joseph are marveling at them? Whatever Simeon knew, this much we can say with certainty. He found peace. He found peace. He found consolation. But what's crazy to me about this story is that Simeon had nothing circumstantially change in his life. He held a baby. That was it. Rome still ruled. People of Israel still caught between apathy and sorrow. But just holding that baby changed everything for Simeon's heart. Do you see? Now, Lord, you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, because my eyes have seen your salvation. Like, what do we do with that? Here's what I think we do with it. Simeon's peace was not attached to anything his senses could tell him made any sense. Nothing changed for Simeon, and yet holding that baby gave him a peace that defied logic. The miracle of Jesus, knowing that God had gone to such lengths to reconcile men and women to himself, not just Jewish men and women, but Gentile men and women too, knowing that God is for us, knowing that he dwells in us, that he's transforming us, this is peace. Where God is, peace is. J. Oswald Sanders says, peace is not the absence of trouble, but the presence of God. Let me say that again. Peace is not the absence of trouble, it's the presence of God. It's crazy. It defies logic. When you know God is for you, when you know he is with you, you can have peace no matter what's going on, even if someone is trying to drown you. It's unclear whether Henry Wadsworth Longfellow ever put his trust in Jesus Christ. We simply don't have a clear poem or writing to know if he did, but we do know that he was deeply religious and he attended church. Do you remember what he wrote in that poem? In despair, I bowed my head. There's no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. But he didn't leave the poem there. He finished it with these words. Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to men. God's not dead. He's not asleep. Doesn't matter if the nation is torn apart by civil war. If I face deep sorrow, if my children are maimed or hurt, God is still in control. And because of that, there is peace on earth, goodwill to men. I don't have to understand it to grab hold of peace. You say, well, what does that mean for me? How can Jesus be my peace? How can he be my peace when I'm quarantined? How can he be my peace when a customer bites my head off, or when my boss treats me terrible, or my kids won't stop fighting, or when my business is shut down due to COVID, or when the paycheck won't stretch to the end of the month, or when my spouse doesn't want to be near me, or when I fail a test and you fill in the blank? How can I find peace? Toby Mack, the Christian recording artist, so succinctly put it when he said, "You cannot expect God to be the source of your peace if the world is the source of your satisfaction." You can't expect God to ever be your source of peace if you find your satisfaction in the world and not in Him. That's why this is such a radical message. If God becomes your source of satisfaction, then when all these other things are stripped away, you can have peace in the midst of the horror. That's why it defies logic. Just stop to think about the different examples of Jesus with his disciples. Like when he separates from them and they're rowing across the Sea of Galilee and the winds and waves are crashing into the boat, and he begins to walk out to them on the water and they're scared to death. And what does Jesus do? He goes to them and he says, "Do not be afraid. It's me." Or when the disciples are grief-stricken at the Last Supper because he's saying, "I've got to go away from you for a while." And what does he say to them? "Do not be afraid. I'm with you. I'm never going to leave. My spirit's going to come." He promised it in John chapter 14, 15, 16, 17. That's what he says to them. "You're not going to be alone." Or even after he dies and he's been raised from the dead and the disciples don't know it yet, all of them. And the two disciples are walking on the road to Emmaus, remember? And Jesus comes alongside them and they don't even know it's him. And he's with them. And as he talks to them, they're so encouraged and they're filled with hope. And when he finally reveals himself and they leave, do you remember what they say? "Did not our hearts burn within us?" With a thrill is what they're saying, because he was with us. Do you see the peace that the presence of Christ brings? If you have Jesus, you have security, all the security you ever need, and that is real peace. So what can you do to fight for it? Well, you can pray for it. If you feel a lack of peace, if you feel anxious, if you feel fear, you can know 100% of the time that's not from God. You can pray and ask God to help you overcome the anxiety. You can memorize scriptures that speak to this peace. Like in Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, that he gives you a peace that surpasses understanding, that guards your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Steel bars that guard you. And the other thing you can do is you can spend time with people who have that peace and remind you of what you have every day. Peace is your birthright, Christian. Take hold of it. Take hold of it. It's your birthright. It's what you get. When we walk without fear, even into horrible circumstances, and we have peace, the world takes notice. And then we get to say, "I have peace that defies logic because I have Jesus." Let's pray. Father, especially in this year. I confess that I have let go of peace at times when I could have grabbed hold of it as my birthright. And I suspect that there are others in our church family that have done the same. We have allowed a virus, a response to a virus, a piece of cloth or paper over one's mouth, the shuttering of businesses, a horrible election, the words of politicians. Online learning, a lack of sports, and so many other things to take peace away and to make our hearts at times like a seething, boiling pot of anxiety. And on this last Sunday of Advent, while we look to the first coming of your Son and we yearn for his second coming, and we are in some ways in between the testaments again, I just want to take a few moments of silence so that we might confess our anxieties and our anger and our fears to you and grasp hold of peace. Would you just confess the sin of your heart to the Father right now? Father, you've written in Isaiah that you keep him in perfect peace, or her in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon you, is resting in you. God, give us a vision that is so consumed with you and with your glory and with your good news that anxiety and fear and anger are hard to come by. Peace is the natural outcome of our lives. We thank you that you sent Jesus to be our peace, to make peace between you and us and between us and us. Father, help us to grab hold of peace in this crazy Christmas season, we ask in Jesus' name.
You know, I never really looked at this song. You know what, Chalice, this is maybe a song that I would probably have chosen to sing at church in this type of scenario. But when I really looked at it, and some things are so familiar, at least for me, I don't know if it ever happens with you, that they become almost cliche. You know, a lot of people know this song, they're familiar with it, and it really loses its meaning. But when you look at this, especially in regard to what Ryan was sharing this morning about Simeon, that you can almost see him saying, "What child is this?" And that's something that I, in my own heart, I want that to happen more, is to be more of a wonder at our Lord Jesus Christ, because that's all we have that's steady, right, and rock. So not to add more words, but let's sing together. It's beautiful hearing you sing. It really is. What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, what shepherds guard our King? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him by, the babe, the Son of Man. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king to roam. The King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the big
recite a benediction from Philippians chapter 4. In nothing be anxious, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your thoughts in Christ Jesus. Amen. If I don't get to see some of you tonight, have a blessed Christmas. I'll see you in a couple weeks when I get back from North Carolina. You're dismissed.